Welcome back, everybody, to another video. Today we'll be checking out the now 15-year-old HD-5830 and seeing how it stacks up in some games. If it could even, boot those games, that is. Hold on to that thought. This here is the Sapphire variant of the 5830, and oh good lord is it just caked in dust. I'll admit, I don't think I managed to get every nook and cranny here, but I did try my best to remove a good majority of it. Please note to anybody dusting something like this, open up a window and have a fan running. Your lungs are absolutely gonna thank you for it. I'm typing this well after I recorded this section of the video, and my nose is still getting flashbacks just thinking about it. Getting on to the card, however, this one released all the way back on February 25th, 2010 under the TerraScale 2 architecture. Costing about $239 at launch from what I could find, it was a more modest offering next to the 5850 at $299. Getting on into the specs, we got our GPU core running at a stock 800 MHz with our memory clocking at 1000. Some variants will run a little bit faster, but not for our little Sapphire here. We do, however, get a pretty beefy 256-bit memory bus to power our whopping 1 GB of GDDR5 memory. However, this card itself is only running on a PCIe 2.0 interface. Our display outs are a little weird here. We get a single DVI, one HDMI, and a mini display port for some reason. Which is kind of weird considering that the other cards usually have a full-size display port and an extra DVI. To power this behemoth, we're gonna need a surprising 175 watts of power over 2 6-pin connectors. Which is kind of weird considering that the higher end 5850 version is only running at 151 watts. I kind of wonder what the deal is there. The real area where this card is suffering is its API and driver support. We do not get DirectX 12 support, nor Vulkan. We're gonna be stuck either using OpenGL or DirectX 11 for our gaming needs. This also isn't mentioning that the most recent official drivers are 9 to 10 years old by now, meaning we're gonna get driver errors for a lot of games, and having to use the raw power of the GPU to struggle against the rest. The ones that are gonna boot, anyways. For our test bench, we've actually got some newer parts in. Mainly, the Ryzen 5 5600T CPU. We'll only have half our normal amount of RAM for this video, as I use some in another build at the moment, but it shouldn't hinder the results in any noticeable way. Let's see how this card holds up in the benchmarks. All recorded on the Elgato HD60+. Starting off with the synthetic benchmarks, these results shouldn't be too much of a surprise, honestly, especially if you watch our video on the HD7770. 2255 for Firemark means we're definitely going to be struggling for a lot of the games here, and funny enough, this is also where the lack of DirectX 12 support means we can't run any of these tests but Firemark. The closest we could get to Time Spy was just Firemark Extreme at 1440p, but not even reaching 800 points means we should really never attempt it. This is the kind of territory where you might actually think of getting a GT 1030, because its scores on the regular Firemark are about 45% higher than this card. That's not an amazing performance difference considering that the 1030 is a whole 7 years newer, but at least you'll still get some modern drivers at the very least. Starting off with a game that released within the card's lifespan, Deus Ex Human Revolution overall wasn't actually too bad. Running at 1080p medium settings, we've actually managed a solid 89 FPS for our averages, while our lows of 29 and 2 were actually more of a result of the game having to load in assets. In smaller areas, it wasn't hard to see upwards of 80 to even 100 FPS, but outside in the hub area, we could see discs down into the 50s, although it seemed to only happen during takedown cutscenes. The game remains to be pretty playable, although that's not too big of a surprise, honestly. It's one of the few games we've actually got proper driver support for in the first place. But checking out an indie title, I'm actually a little surprised that Repo even booted, as I would have thought this game was DirectX 12, but nope, it's actually 11. It also ran pretty well, actually, even with the lowered settings. 1080p low, we averaged 59 FPS with pretty good lows of 46 and 9. It was generally a smooth experience until you really hit a shop or an area with a lot of effects going on, like any of the extraction points. But overall, I would say that this is actually pretty playable, and you could have some fun with your friends if you really wanted to. Shin Megami Tensei 5 isn't actually playable on this card without a bit of a workaround. Booting it normally says it cannot run in DirectX 12 mode, and to try running it without the command. If we put in DX11 in the launch options, however, the game will boot up with seemingly no issue. I'm not certain if there's actually any problems with this, as I haven't extensively tested playing with DirectX 11, but we certainly cannot deny its results. We've had to take a pretty decent hit to the visual quality here, as by running at 768p, we only managed an average of 46 FPS with our lows of 21 and 1. This is also with ambient occlusion and anti-aliasing disabled. Fluctuating frame rates is pretty common here, especially while openly exploring DOT, and you can see some noticeable slowdown at the start of battles. However, I would still say that this is pretty playable, especially if you're already used to the Switch version. At least here, you're going to get an average higher frame rate. Getting on into some competitive multiplayer action, Counter-Strike 2 is really running up against the limits of the older card here, and it's just barely usable. Taking a major visual sacrifice at 720p low, with performance FSR enabled, we barely managed to scrape by a 60 FPS average, while our lows were at 39 and 25. The fluctuating frame rate and overall pixelated nature of the visuals means this card shouldn't really be used beyond most casual game modes, and even then, I doubt it'll be worth it. Usable? In a pinch. But should you? Not at all. Performance mode is the one thing keeping Fortnite playable with a card this old, and even then, it's struggling quite a bit here. 1080p medium settings at 75% resolution scale, we just managed to average a 66 FPS average, although our lows are at an atrocious 18 and 8. Once again, just like Counter-Strike, fluctuating frame times keeps it from being anything more than a casual experience, and trying to fix it will just reduce the already sacrificed visual quality even further. Keep yourself to those more casual custom maps, or maybe just boot up some Lego Fortnite. Not recommended by any means, but it is usable if you've got nothing better. Next up was Skyrim. The game ran overall pretty decently in my opinion, although you can tell this card can't quite keep up. 1080p low with no anti-aliasing enabled, we're running at a pretty decent 55 FPS average, with lows of 36 and 16. In more compact spaces like inside dungeons or buildings, we can usually see around that 55 to 60 FPS mark, while the open world is more into the 40s to 45s. While I wouldn't say this is a preferable way to play this game, the original would probably run a lot better, you can still have a decent time with this card. While I could recommend a resolution drop, if you saw the footage for SMT5, you can see that it just seems to shrink the window, even in full screen mode, instead of just stretching it out. Overall, it's playable, just a little iffy though. Black Mesa remains to be one of those special cases of being both visually amazing and actually pretty easy to run overall. Running at 1080p potato settings, we've managed a pretty solid 82 FPS average, although as always, our point lows are a little inconsistent here. Before they got obliterated by a loading screen, they were 55 and 25 respectively. Overall, it did manage to keep around 60 FPS most of the time, only briefly falling into the mid-50s on occasion while going through the Zen overworld. Now, this is not an ideal way to play, but as I said before, this game running this smoothly on a 15-year-old card at an HD resolution, even if the settings are very low, that's very admirable in my opinion. Subnautica is an interesting case here, because while we didn't have the raw performance to keep it stably at 60 FPS, it was actually really stable frame rate wise. 1080p low preset finds us getting a 55fps on average, with really good lows actually of 34 and 30. Depending on the scene, we could see a drop down to 45 frames, but overall, it was actually really smooth. The only real trouble spot was watching the Enterprise explode, which had just enough of particle effects to shoot our frames down below even what the 1% was recording at the time. A small resolution drop could be beneficial, but I don't think you would actually have too many complaints if you wanted to play the game like this. Vintage Story is a game that can scale decently well to pretty much whatever you've got, as long as it supports OpenGL. And this card definitely is supporting that theory, even if there's some bumps in the road. Running at a 1080p resolution at 75% scale on the very low preset, we actually managed a pretty decent 76fps, although our lows leave something to be desired at 27 and 21 respectively. This is very noticeable if you take a look at how wild our frame times can get. Radeon cards are noted to have certain issues with the frame rate in this game, but it certainly isn't helped with our ever lacking graphical prowess hampering us down. Overall, I would still say Vintage Story is still playable, but further tweaking may just be required here. Or Linux, honestly. Overall, the Radeon HD-5830 is surprisingly not as bad as I thought, really. Yeah, it can't support any modern renderer beyond DirectX 11, Vulkan is completely non-existent, but the game performance isn't actually completely terrible. That's not to mention that this card wasn't really even made with 1080p in mind in the first place as it is. Around the time of this card's release, 1024x768p was the most used resolution at the time, at least by StatCounter's findings. So the fact that we could push this mid-range card to 1080p and still actually get a somewhat usable experience is at the very least admirable in my opinion. Is it useful in the modern day? Not really, no. Especially not with the advent of Windows 11 slowly being forced onto everybody at the end of the year. But for something like a retro gaming machine, Linux, which I might test in a future video, or just playing some simpler indie titles, it's not that bad if you have one just laying around. I wouldn't recommend buying one in the first place though, but if you do, they seem to go anywhere from about 20 to 40 bucks on eBay as of the time of this video. I would like to thank everybody for watching. I've been pretty busy lately, so I apologize for not getting this video out sooner, but things should start picking up again soon, and I'm already scripting up the next video as we speak. Stay tuned for more, and until then, have a great day.